We present before you a case of laparoscopic gastric bypass. It's a conventional approach with which we are doing. One of the important things here is that you do a diagnostic laparoscopy and then park this thick omentum just below the edge of the liver so that it does not come into your way. If you'll park the thick omentum in the transverse colon at the edge of the liver, just below the edge, you will be able to see this ligament of Treitz as I am able to see. And then just try and form a C loop with this particular small bowel, that is the jejunum, and try and pull out the bowel to do a diagnostic laparoscopy in the form of a C loop. If you make this C loop, you will be able to trace the bowel and also you will be able to count it very easily, just the way I am doing it. Again, I go near the ligament of Treitz, see it, follow it at 75 cm from the duodeno-jejunal junction, and once I have followed 75 cm, I'll take a white cartridge and divide it exactly midline with both the bowels, mesentery in between. As you can see, it is totally hemostatic. I'll mark my elementary limb here so that I do not get confused, and I have taken a black silk to mark my elementary limb, which is going to go up towards the pouch for the anastomosis. I'll further divide my mesentery because I would want a very tension-free anastomosis. One of the tricks here is that because you are close to the staple line, first you should use a harmonic to divide and then finally you can come with a ligature, because a ligature won't work with the clips or the cartridges there. It perceives them as a foreign body. We'll again count 110 centimeters. And then after counting 110 centimeters, we are going to anastomose it with the biliopancreatic limb. I'll take a harmonic and make an enterotomy, dilate it with the harmonic only. Again, I'll make an enterotomy here at the 3 o'clock position. We will insert a white cartridge inside to do the anastomosis. Initially, we were using a blue cartridge, but now we use a white cartridge because it looks more hemostatic for anastomosis with this thin, with this jejunum. I'll now close this particular defect using a Vicryl, which is a Vicryl 2-0, as we do it in our conventional open surgeries. And once we have closed, we take a stay and then we will close this defect. Now the principle is that we will try to bury the mucosa in the very first stage when we are closing the defect. And then we'll take the second layer with a silk. This is silk 2-0. We'll try to cover every defect and take a second layer. I feel that this is the safest kind of anastomosis which we can do with all these techniques, because it is same like we do it in our open surgeries. There is no gap which is there, and there is a good serosal cover. It looks very safe, it looks very hemostatic. So I feel that one should not compromise on the principles of closing the defects and suturing. You should follow the same principles as we do in open surgery. I always do it in two layers. We will close the mesenteric defects using again a silk, which is a non-absorbable suture. And this is the defect which has to be closed compulsorily, because there can be a chances of internal hernias. The trick here is don't take too much deep bite, just take 1-1.5 centimeter deep bite, and you will not damage any vasculature there, because a hematoma with a bleed at this place can be very dangerous. Not only it can compromise the supply, but also it can lead to abscesses, intra-abdominal abscesses in future in diabetic patients. So one should be very particular, and this suture line should go up till that place so that you do not leave a single defect there while you are doing this anastomosis. There have been cases where these internal hernias have been reported even years after the bariatric surgery. So it's better that we avoid them. We will divide this thick pad of omentum, greater omentum, which is there, so as to avoid tension over our limb. We'll go close to the base of the transverse colon, and under vision we divide. As I said, my technique here would be a pars flexura technique to make the pouch. we open the pars flexida and try and search for the pancreas there. There is a thin flimsy layer over the pancreas and we enter the lesser sac very easily. Divide this these vessels of gastric veins there and then I fire a horizontal purple tri-staple cartridge to make the horizontal fire. Pull in the boogie inside the pouch and then fire the vertical one. We'll use a gold finger to dissect here, and a gold finger is a very useful device, and then once we have dissected we'll insert in our cartridge. So this is our pouch. We'll bring in the loop of the jejunum up. We'll make a enterotomy here, dilate it, and now we are making another enterotomy at the junction of the horizontal and the vertical staple line of the stomach. We dilate both the enterotomies and gastrotomies, introduce the stapler, and we fire it exactly at 3 to 3.5 centimeters. Cross in the boogie across, and once the boogie is across we'll repair this particular stomach. Again the same principle which we follow in all our bypasses. We will take the first layer with the silk with the Vicryl 20 and try and bury as much as mucosa as possible. But we always have a second layer with a silk in all these cases. The gastric calibration tube might put some amount of pressure initially, but it is a very safe technique because we do not take the posterior layer in all these cases, and these patients will not have stromal stenosis and dysphagia later on, because we know that we have properly calibrated that particular area. Also, there is less incidence of nausea and vomiting in all these patients once you have passed the GCT. You can also pass the GCT after taking the first layer and then passing the GCT, but that I think puts pressure if you unnecessarily force it, and that might cut through your stitches. The second layer which I'll take will be with a silk, and I'll bury these layers. Which I have taken by the Vicryl, and we always try and avoid the vessels, major vessels there at the lesser curvature, because if you take these vessels along with the second layer it becomes very difficult because of the fact that if they bleed there will be a lot of hematoma at that place. So we try and avoid, and this helps us in avoiding any hematoma near the pouch of jejunostomy. Thank you very much.